Today we will be covering three subjects. First, women and family laws. Second, role of National Commission for Women. Thirdly, Legal Services Authorities Act. For the first session, we have with us a legal luminary, Shri Shekhar Napade, Senior Advocate, Supreme Court of India. His contribution to the glory of justice and majesty of law is well known. Sir, around 400 advocates from 8 states are participating in this training program, and we have been waiting for this lecture, sir. And we are grateful on behalf of NALSA. I welcome you, sir, and I thank you for accepting our invitation at such a short notice. So, without further ado, I request your good self to deliver the lecture. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. At the outset, I must thank the National Legal Services Authority for giving me an opportunity to share whatever bit that I have learned in this profession. Now, let me begin by saying that when we think of empowerment of women, what precisely is in our mind? In the first place, let me say unhesitatingly that in this country, for last more than 150 years, there is a new social revolution which is on. People have a misconception about the revolution. A revolution doesn't mean an event which has taken place. This expression is misunderstood in a political context when there is a change in the regime. But in the context of a social revolution, we must remember that it's an ongoing process. It is difficult to trace when it started, and difficult for me to conceive as to when it is going to end, or whether it is going to end at all. Now, let me begin by setting up my concept of empowerment. In the first place, the concept of empowerment essentially takes in its compass emancipation. Emancipation of the women folk is an essential ingredient of the concept of empowerment. Now, how do we develop this thesis further? If you are a theist, you will believe that rights of men, in which I include the rights of women, they come not from the generosity of the state or of an organized society. They come from hand of God. If you are an atheist or an agnostic, you will say that these rights come from nature. So, whichever philosophy that you may belong to, in every woman, whether a child or an aged woman, they have certain inherent rights by being human beings. Now, this is the hallmark of any civilized state any civilized country, by any civilized society. Now, these natural rights are recognized by the state. Let me hasten to add that the state merely recognizes them, that they exist. But these rights exist. Unless the state takes them away by any competent legislation. Now, why am I relating these natural rights to empowerment of women with reference to the family laws? There is an inseparable link between these natural rights and the rights of women under the relevant family laws. The family laws that are enacted in this country or any part of the world are a mere recognition that these rights exist. They are not the source. The source, as I have indicated, these are natural rights, or they come from hand of God. Now, as far as India is concerned, when the constitution was ushered in on 26th of January 1950, you have a charter of rights, which we describe them as fundamental rights. The basic right or the soul of the constitution flows from Article 21. The concept of liberty . If this concept is properly construed, it takes in its compass all other fundamental rights. Now, how do I relate this fundamental right contained in Article 21 to the family laws? See, there is a link between the natural law, natural rights of a human being, the fundamental rights which recognize such natural rights, and the statutory provisions which give a concrete shape to these rights. Now, Article 21, as I said, is the soul of the Constitution. Of late, this concept of liberty has received very liberal construction. Historically, when the Constitution was ushered in, a limited range of rights were comprehended within the ambit of Article 21. But gradually in years to come, the Supreme Court and the High Courts have interpreted it very liberally. Now let me relate these natural rights to the family laws. Take, for example, a right to education. Is there any provision in any family law which specifically refers to a right of a girl child to pursue education. Because education is a means by which you liberate yourself. Sa vidyaya vimuktaye. What does that mean? Education is something that liberates you from poverty. It liberates you from bondage. It liberates you from all kind of social shackles which affect your freedom. So right to education, now recognized under Article 21A, includes a right of a girl child to education. Now, is education necessary or not for the purpose of enjoying other rights, for the purpose of her emancipation, for the purpose of her empowerment? The very concept of empowerment takes in its compass a right to education. So even if there is no specific provision in any of the family laws, a girl child or a female or a lady or even an aged woman has a right to pursue education. Now, how do I relate it to 21? Can her parents object to her education? Can her husband object to her education? Can her in-laws object to her education? Answer is no. She is emancipated. She is empowered. So therefore, she has a right to pursue education. No empowerment is possible without a right to pursue education. After education, she has a right to seek means of livelihood. Can her in-laws object to her employment? Answer is no. She is a free person. She is an emancipated woman. She is an empowered woman. She has a right to pursue her career, her employment, her vocation, or whatever that she chooses to do. After education, we come to her matrimonial rights. Now, matrimonial rights begin with first a right to choose a husband. Now, is there any specific provision in any of the matrimonial laws which says that she is free? It need not be. Because she is a free citizen, she is an emancipated woman, she is an empowered woman, she is entitled to choose her husband. And neither the parents nor anybody else can force her to enter into any matrimony against her wishes. Now you come to the other matrimonial rights. What are those rights which are recognized by all matrimonial laws? A right to seek divorce. A right to maintenance. A right not to be treated with cruelty. Now, all these rights are barely a reflection of her fundamental rights. Now, can she be forced to continue a marriage or cohabitation or a matrimonial status against her wishes? Answer is no. All matrimonial laws have undergone a sea change. There is a paradigm shift. And this was inevitable. We'll briefly see what are the grounds which are enumerated in various matrimonial laws. And each of them, you will find, is a reflection of the fundamental rights. Each of them. We'll just take Hindu Marriage Act and quickly see the grounds. By now, I believe you must be familiar with the different matrimonial laws which operate in this country. Section 13 gives that. First, as after the solemnization of the marriage, had a voluntary sexual intercourse with any person other than his or her spouse, or as after the solemnization of the marriage, treated the petitioner with cruelty, has deserted the petitioner for a continuous period of not less than 2 years, ceased to be a Hindu by conversion, has been incurably of unsound mind, or has been suffering continuously or intermittently from mental disorder, has been suffering from venereal disease in a communicable form, has renounced the world by entering into any religious order, or has not been heard of as being alive. Each of these grounds is a recognition of our fundamental rights. It's a statutory recognition of the fundamental rights. In other words, our fundamental right has been given a concrete shape. In practically, matrimonial laws of different religions contain more or less the same grounds, with some minor differences. Even as amongst the Muslims, if you see the Muslim women's right to seek dissolution, that 1939 Act, which practically covers the same field, but there is one interesting feature which is often not noticed. And that is, again, a recognition of a fundamental right. And that provision in that 1939 Act is now, which recognizes a right to practice a religion of one's choice. 39 Act contains a very significant provision, which is often lost sight of. It lays down that merely because the wife changes her religion, the marriage does not stand dissolved ipso facto. Isn't this a recognition of our fundamental right to practice a religion of our choice? You take Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act. you deal with any aspect of family law, you will find that there is only a concrete shape is given to the fundamental right. We'll quickly see some of these rights. Now, that 1939 Act, which I pointed out to you, a very significant provision, I'll read out that provision to you. Anyway, I am not able to trace out that provision for the time being. Now we'll go to the right to seek maintenance. Now this concept of maintenance has also undergone a sea change. Historically, the idea of maintenance was that's sufficient for shelter, clothing, and food. This is an old idea. Today, the concept is that a wife is entitled to the same standard of living, the same facilities as the husband has. In other words, equality. This concept of maintenance, to have a same standard of living, isn't it an aspect of Article 14. Now let us see the right to adopt. Section 8 of the Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act permits a female to adopt a child. This is what the section says. A female Hindu who is of sound mind, who is not a minor, and who is not married, or if married, whose marriage has been dissolved, or whose husband is dead, or has completely and finally renounced the world, or has ceased to be a Hindu, or has been declared by a court of competent jurisdiction to be of unsound mind, has the capacity to take a son or a daughter in adoption. Now, a right to have a child is also a part of her liberty under Article 21. Apart from adopting the child, in the circumstances set out in Section 8, she has the right to decide when she should have a child or whether she should not have a child at all. She cannot be forced to have a child. Now, this again is a part of her fundamental right. Let's see Section 7 of the Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act. A male Hindu can adopt a child, but if his wife is living, he must have the consent of the wife. Isn't that a recognition of Article 14? The point which I have been trying to make is that all family laws flow out of the Charter of Fundamental Rights. And some of these rights, according to me, could have been enforced even in the absence of the matrimonial laws in the field. For example, I'll give you an example. As far as Jews in India are concerned, there is yet not a statutory provision which deals with marriages and divorces. They're still governed by certain common law principles. Does that mean that there is no right to seek a divorce? No. Even at common law, a right to seek divorce is recognized. Of course, on the well-established grounds. So, the point which I am making is that the empowerment of the women, something which inheres in them, their emancipation inheres in them, and the statutes only put a seal of approval. Now, we dealt with her matrimonial rights, which also takes in its compass the custody of children in case the marriage breaks down. As far as a girl child is concerned, usually it is the mother, unless there are some exceptional reasons. As far as a male child is concerned, up to a certain age, the custody has to go with the mother. In all civilized countries across the globe, a mother has been recognized as a fit and proper person to take care of the children, unless there are some compelling factors which require the court to take a different view. Even under the Guardian Watch Act, which deals with the custody and guardianship of a child, the mother has to be preferred. First, also understand a fundamental difference between guardianship and custody. Even under certain personal laws, the guardianship rules may be different. But as far as the custody is concerned, the mother's preferential right to custody has to be recognized and is invariably recognized unless there are compelling reasons to take a different view. Why mother is chosen? Because affection, love, comes naturally to a mother. This does not mean that it doesn't come to the father. But if you see, the mother is willing to sacrifice everything for the child, which perhaps the father may hesitate to do. The God has created mother, as they say, because he can't be with each and every child. Therefore, mother is supposed to be the representative of God. That's the concept, which is judicially recognized and which is, at one point of time, as far as Hindus were concerned, there was a debate that father is the first guardian and after father comes the mother. But the Supreme Court said no. That mother also is on the same footing as the father as far as guardianship is concerned. And it is not that the father has a preferential right and that mother has his rights are secondary. This principle is negative. This is again based on Article 14. Again based on Article 21. Now we saw her, quickly we saw her matrimonial rights, but as far as the Christian community in India is concerned, the right to seek divorce was restricted. The grounds which are available to the people following other religions, like Hindus, Parsis, were not available to the Christian community. The 2001 amendment made a lot of difference to the Indian, that Divorce Act of 1869, which governs the Christians in India. How it started, why 2001 amendment came? Of course, as I said, that a new social revolution is ongoing. And even the Christian community in India could not be left behind. The immediate reason, if I am asked to find out, there was one provision in the 1869 Act, earlier unamended Act, that one of the grounds of divorce was incestuous adultery coupled with cruelty. And the provision, this particular provision, especially that incestuous adultery and coupled with cruelty, this came to be attacked in a petition under Article 226 filed in Kerala High Court. And on the basis of fundamental rights, Articles 14, 21, etc., Kerala High Court came to the conclusion that this provision is violative of fundamental rights. The Parliament responded to this recognition of this ongoing social revolution and responded to the judgment of the Kerala High Court. And we have a 2001 amended 1869 Divorce Act, which applies to. Now, except the right of a male Muslims to divorce his wife, which is an issue which is in the debate currently. As far as all other religions are concerned, the grounds of divorce, the claim for maintenance is almost the same, with some minor differences here and there. But even as far as the Muslim community is concerned, the Domestic Violence Act has made a huge impact on the matrimonial laws or matrimonial relationships or family relations. Look at its provisions. This act has ushered in a new social revolution, has given a new dimension to this process of accelerated the concept of marriage in the first place. This is the secular concept. All other laws, Hindu Marriage Act, Parsi Marriage and Divorce Act, Christian Marriage Act, or the customary law or Shariat based law of the Muslims, all these marriages have some religious sanction. Except, of course, the Special Marriage Act 1954 or the Foreign Marriage Act 1969. But this act recognizes a relationship which is in the nature of a marriage. Some doubts, questions were raised about the morality of such a concept. But let me state that after all, it is not such an immoral concept. A living relationship is not a casual relationship. It may not have been formalized in the form of a matrimonial ties, but the two people who are emotionally involved want to live together. What else it is but a marriage? Now, the recognition of this relationship for matrimonial reliefs, I'm putting the expression matrimonial in inverted commas for a want of a better expression. See, it grants all those reliefs, maintenance, right of residence, shared household. Now, recognition of this kind of relationship not merely confined to a particular religious group. Of course, it also recognizes marriages which are solemnized in accordance with the relevant religious rituals. But in addition to that, this kind of relationship creating a relationship in the nature of a marriage is, according to me, giving a new impetus to the concept of freedom which underlies any legal system of any civilized country. Now let's quickly see her social and cultural rights. Do they come from any family law? Answer is no. The way she dresses up, her hairstyle, the kind of films that she wants to see, or the kind of literature that she wants to read, these are her rights which no family law or no husband or no in-laws or anybody else can prevent her from doing so, what she wants to do. So let's not have a limited concept of the family laws. The family laws is only a small portion. When I say family laws, means the enacted statutes. But the fundamental law of the country is constitution and the fundamental rights enshrined in Article 14 and 21, which together constitute the soul of the Indian constitution. All her rights, qua the family or the so-called concept of family laws, the Gangotri is the constitution. And as I said, the constitution only recognizes the natural rights which inhere in every woman. The new concept that she has a right, even in matrimonial laws, what are her rights? Can she be forced to have sex against her wish? Answer is no. Can she be forced to have a child against her wish? Answer is no. As long as we contemplate the idea of empowerment, there can be no empowerment unless there is emancipation. And it is this concept of emancipation, which is inherent in her fundamental rights, gives her a right to seek divorce when the marriage can't work. The other aspect of empowerment and emancipation is her property rights. The Hindu Succession Act was amended in 2005, Section 6. And a girl or a lady or a woman is given same rights as her male counterpart. They become co-partners into Hindu undivided family. Isn't this a complete breakaway from the past? The 2005 amendment to Section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act is only a recognition of the new social revolution which was gathering momentum across the country as a part of a global movement. Incidentally, I may refer to a galaxy of professors, American lady professors. Their feminism movement has gone to this extent that they have opened up all American Supreme Court judgments of last almost 200 years, and they are examining each and every judgment from a perspective of feminism, and they are rewriting those judgments. The educated women folk in India, would they lack it? I hope somebody undertakes that job. So the property right, first, this concept of the daughters being co-partners. This movement first was developed in four important states: Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, and Maharashtra. All these states had made an amendment to the Hindu Succession Act on the same lines as 2005 amendment. So the forces which were generated, the social forces which were generated in these four states ultimately reached Delhi. I forget which state first started this, perhaps Andhra. My memory may not be accurate. But simultaneously, almost around the same time, Andhra, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, and Maharashtra made their respective amendments. In fact, Andhra has a new law for empowerment of the girls. It's a 2013 enactment. Perhaps Andhra is leading the country. Once upon a time, South was said to be more orthodox. But today, I think the South is leading, at least from these statutory provisions. Now, recognizing her property rights on the same footing as the son, isn't that a recognition of Article 14 of the Constitution and Article 21? So, my thesis that all family laws have to conform. Not only conform, they flow from articles of fundamental rights, articles relating to fundamental rights contained in the Constitution. So we saw her right to pursue education, her right to seek livelihood of her choice. From where does she get the right to seek livelihood? And even against the wishes of the husband, it comes out of Article 21. The right to seek parity with the husband comes from 1421. Her social and cultural rights also come from those articles. The right to seek maintenance comes out of those articles. The right to have adoption also comes from those articles. The statutes are merely putting their imprimatur. They are not the source. Those are fundamental rights, and even the fundamental rights only recognize the natural rights. Now, I have given my perspective, my own philosophical approach to the matrimonial laws or family laws, qua the concept of emancipation and empowerment. But there is one vital topic which I would like to discuss with you. As I said, that there is a social revolution which is on, and that revolution is not one isolated event. It's a continuous process. There are several other laws which also recognize this phenomena. You have the Maternity Benefit Act. You have the sexual harassment at workplaces, etc. These are all recognition of the fundamental rights, a right to dignity, even in matrimonial relationships. Now, I talked about this social revolution . The law is a function of social revolution, to put it in the language of calculus. This social revolution can get accelerated by legislation. The relationship between a social movement and law is symbiotic. Law is generated by social forces, or it recognizes what is just and proper, what is just and fair. The very concept of being just and fair is nothing but a recognition of the fundamental rights of man. Now, as I said at the beginning, that it is difficult to locate when this social revolution started. We have to begin somewhere, because all record of history is arbitrary, because you have to begin somewhere. If I go to Vedic period or Upanishadic period, the feminism was recognized as a Shakti, as a power. In Indian history, we have so many ladies of great intellectual capacity, Gargi and Maitreya. Any student of history, social history especially, has to remember these two ladies. And as far as Gargi is concerned, there is a very interesting anecdote about her. She was the wife of Yajnavalkya, who was one of the great Rishis and one of the great lawgivers. But Gargi had achieved such intellectual height that she asked questions after questions to her husband. She was not only on par intellectually with her husband, but perhaps a notch above. Her husband, Yajnavalkya, poor fellow, couldn't cope up with her questioning and took Vairagya. My advice to ladies is be Gargi, but don't go to that extent. So we have this history of Vedic times where we had such powerful ladies of who had achieved great eminence for their intellectual powers. So I come back to my original thesis, Sa Vidyaya Vibhukte, education is that liberates. Somewhere in the medieval times or in the Middle Ages, all these great Indian traditions of respecting women, women being on par with the men folk, somewhere that movement degenerated. And our daughters, girls, ladies, we started considering them as chattels. Even in Europe, the wife was considered to be the chattel of the husband. Anyway, we came out of that dark age, of that middle age. But social events continued for many, many, many years. Now the current legislation relating to family laws, if I am asked to trace out, my mind goes back to Bengal. Point of time, Bengalis used to believe, and perhaps rightly so, that what Bengal does, the rest of India follows. The first evil practice that was sought to be eliminated was the practice of sati. The Lord Bentinck, you know that Calcutta was the capital of India till 1911. It is the Bengal Regulation of 1829 which declared sati as unlawful, illegal. This was a result of a social reform movement which started in Bengal. Vidyasagar, Ishwar Chandra Sharun, popularly known as Vidyasagar, was one of the leading lights of this social movement. The social movement started gathering strength. You had the Brahmo Samaj movement, you had Prarthana Samaj movement, you had Raja Ramamurthy Rai, you had Vidyasagar. We had Phule and Agarkar in Maharashtra. The social reformers came. They were first ridiculed, but then gradually, every thinking Indian saw that certain evil practices must stop and the women must be given their legitimate dues and you must recognize their dignity as free individuals. Vidyasagar, Ishwarchandra Vidyasagar, was the pioneer. The Hindu Widow Remarriage Act 1856. Is a result of his untiring efforts. Till that time, till the Hindu widow remarriages were legalized by a process of legislation, these marriages were considered as void, illegal. Children were not considered as legitimate. In other words, the society consigned these women, unfortunate women who lost their husbands, to almost miserable conditions. They were not supposed to take part in religious ceremonies, marriages, social functions. They were considered as taboo. It was some kind of solitary confinement to them. Now, this recognition that they have a right to get married again and to start their life all over again is a result of a powerful social movement led by Vidyasagar ji. Therefore, at the beginning I said that there is a social revolution which is on. Every concept of empowerment has two components. One is the legal framework which recognizes or gives an impetus or acts as a catalyst to a social movement. But the legal framework is nothing but a result of the social movements. The sati pratha, sati practices came to be abolished not merely because there was a law. Even after 1829, when Lord Bentinck enacted the legislation, the practices continued until the conscience of the community, the conscience of this country was aroused that this is something inhuman. So there is always a close co-relationship between the social movement and the law. There cannot be progressive legislation unless these social movements require the legislature to respond to the demand of the situation. I have dealt with the co-relationship between the legal framework and the social movements. I have dealt with the family laws and the basic concepts of freedom. But now I want to make a note of caution. There should not be a reverse discrimination. There are two things to which I want to invite your attention. One is that all these matrimonial laws, family laws, domestic violence, whether the benefits have percolated to the rural areas. This is basically something which is confined to urban areas. We need a research that to what extent the benefits of these laws have percolated to the rural areas. and more so amongst them, the depressed and the oppressed section of the community. I was shocked that even in places near Delhi, Bombay, the girls are still not being sent to schools. This is the position around the metropolitan areas. Of course, under the right to education, government is doing its best. All kinds of schemes are there. Kasturba, the scheme under Kasturba Gandhi's name of a residential school for the girls. But I see two distinct trends. Very affluent class, highly educated class. The ladies from these groups have taken benefit. Sometimes they are gone overboard. For example, the Dowry Prohibition Act, even the apex court was required to take judicial notice of the fact that this provision is often misused. This is not a good trend. And my experience tells me that those who are really the victims of these social evils like dowry, exploitation, cruelty, their voice rarely reaches the courtrooms. And this is a very alarming situation. I personally feel that a comprehensive sociological study is required to be made, especially in the rural areas, to what extent the benefits of these welfare laws have reached where they ought to reach. In this context, I must invite your attention to an excellent study made by a young lady. Her name is Sonal Mohar. She has a doctorate from IIT, and she chose a very interesting subject, that after Article 21A became a part of the constitution and a right to education became a fundamental right, even though to a limited extent, and the Kasturba Gandhi Balika Vidyalaya scheme and Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, these movements started, she has made a deep study of the impact of this legislation on the children. And she has come out with an excellent research article. I recommend to you this article. You will get it on Google if you put the name Sonal Mohar. My congratulations to her. I have not met her or not heard of her earlier, but I came across this article and I think I must put my appreciation. Now, the spectrum of family laws and empowerment is very vast. I have tried to cover the basic philosophical aspects. I have tried to indicate to you that these are all a result of a powerful social movement. And if the benefits of this welfare legislation is to reach where it hasn't reached so far, it is our responsibility as advocates to accelerate this process. Any effort in that direction will make its own contribution, however humble it may be. After all, a big lake comes into being with drops and drops of water. No social movement acquires strength and force overnight. It requires some drops of work coming together and the movement acquires force. This is all what I wanted to convey to you. And before I end, I must thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to put my perspective on the empowerment and emancipation of half the Indian population. Before I end, I would like to quote Rabindranath Tagore. And the picture that he painted, he was a great poet, a great painter, and a great human being. His message in Gitanjali is perennial. It's a perennial source of inspiration to all right-thinking people. I quote him. And I end. He says, Gurudev says, where the mind is without fear and the head is held high, where knowledge is free, where the words come out from the depth of the truth, where the world has not been broken into fragments by narrow domestic war, where the clear stream of reason has not lost its way into the dreary desert sand of dead habit, where tireless striving stretches its arm towards perfection, and where the mind is led forward by thee into ever-widening thought and action, into that heaven of freedom, my father, let my country. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for such informative, enlightening, and insightful address. And rightly said that we have to reach out to the unreached, particularly those living in rural and remote areas. Sir, during this campaign, we will strike. And on behalf of NALSA, sir, I thank you, sir, for sparing your valuable time for this training program. And we are thankful to sir. Thank you very much, sir.
My pleasure, sir.